Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. Welcome to St. Peter's Lutheran Church on this Lord's Day. Today, fellowship does follow our time of worship. There's Christian education for Sunday school and confirmation youth at 10:15. Today, the 10th grade confirmands are going to meet with me in my office, but the younger confirmands and the Sunday school youth will meet downstairs as usual. Please do take note of all the announcements that are in your bulletin. I want to highlight that today we're continuing to do the Collecting Change for Kids Against Hunger. There's a display right directly in the hall over there. There's M&M containers. We invite you to take one, enjoy the M&Ms, and then if you would, just return that empty container, but fill it with change, and you can put it in the basket that's on the table there. It only takes 24 cents to provide someone with a nutritious meal through Kids Against Hunger. And so we invite you to help us do some good. Please give generously. Today we're happy to have with us a couple folks from Luther Seminary. We invited Krista Lind and Catherine Osley to be with us and share a little bit about seminary and how we can be supportive of the work they do to encourage and educate leaders in the church. Krista will be sharing with us a temple talk early in the service, and they'll both be available during the coffee hour to answer any questions. Today we'll be taking a special love offering. So on your way out, you'll notice there's a basket in the back and a basket on the side. Our synod collects funds, those funds go toward helping new pastors in our synod who usually come in carrying a lot of debt from their education, and that money goes to help them to relieve that debt. So part of that love offering will go toward that fund and then part toward Luther Seminary. Please take note of the items that are needed for Lutheran World Relief baby kits and personal care kits. That list is by the doors in the entry. Those items need to be here by next Sunday. And 1 o'clock today, this announcement didn't get into your bulletin. It's been on Facebook though. Maybe you have noticed that at 1 o'clock today at the MS or the college in Detroit Lakes, there is a special gathering called Meet Our Muslim Neighbor. And this is a time of conversation. It's a time to ask questions and to, in a friendly atmosphere, to learn more about the Muslim faith, to help dispel a lot of the fear and anxiety that comes up around issues relating to that lately. This is a gathering that's been put together by area clergy. It starts at 1 o'clock at the college in Detroit Lakes. Meet our Muslim neighbor. And next Sunday, we will have a special guest joining us, and I'd like to invite Darren Leno to come forward and share with us a little about that.
Morning, everybody. Next week, you know, on council, we've been looking at ways that we can find funds to enhance some of the giving that we, and some of the things that we do here at St. Peter's. So we've learned that we haven't really been taking advantage of all of the benefits that our Thrivent members can bring to the church. I know that we know there's 42 people here who have Thrivent products, and next week we're going to have somebody here who will be able to talk to us about the programs that can benefit St. Peter's. For example, each Thrivent member can do up to $500 worth of projects, and we wanted to kind of explain that because there might be some things that we can do to enhance the giving of Thrivent members and to help St. Peter's do more. For example, we painted the room downstairs. The Sunday school room downstairs, and that was a Thrivent project. So the materials were purchased, and we'll have another example next week. And other members we have some members in the church that are pretty savvy in using those programs, and we'd just like to explain that. It's not a hard sell sales pitch or anything like that, but it's going to be a 10-minute meeting after church next Sunday. If you're interested, you're welcome. But if you are a Thriven member or know some Thriven members, please join us, and we'll even have some cookies out here. And we just want to explain it so that we can take advantage of this going forward. It's a really good program, and it's kind of a shame. So, you know, 42 people, potentially, if we could tap all those dollars, it'd be $21,000 worth of benefit if we could do that. That seems unlikely, but, you know, even if we could do $5,000, $10,000 in some of these programs, it could really really help our budget, and also just really accelerate what St. Peter's does, all the good things that we do. So, thanks.
Are there any other announcements this morning? Then please stand as we begin worship. We gather this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. And let's sing. We sing, "We Are All One in Mission."
Thank you.
Our prayer of the day is printed on your celebrate insert. Please pray this with me. Benevolent, merciful God, when we are empty, fill us. When we are weak in faith, strengthen us. When we are cold in love, warm us, that with fervor we may love our neighbors and serve them for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. And at this time, I invite Krista Lind to come forward. She works at Luther Seminary. She's been working there for about the last 17 years. Actually, Krista and I know each other from way, way back, too. Well, we haven't seen each other for 22 years, but we did meet back in the day. But thank you for being with us this morning.
Well, thank you for the invitation, and we're grateful to be here. My colleague Catherine is back here as well, and we are so blessed to worship with you this morning and to hear all the ways that you as the body of Christ are at work in the world. And we thank you for your ministry. And I'm grateful to be here among you today and to talk a little bit about seminary education. As she said, we come from Luther Seminary, which is in St. Paul, Minnesota. And our ministry there is to prepare leaders to go out and to be leaders in Christian communities. And there's so many ways that our students are a part of what is happening in the body of Christ all over the world. We were grateful this year to welcome over 100 new students into our programs and to hear about the ways that their life is being stirred to continue in their work. These students come from all over the country and all over the world. We have 14 new international students as well that come from China and Africa and South America and the Caribbean, and we are grateful for the ways that they enhance our living and learning communities together. Our students, while mostly come from the ELCA, also represent 41 different denominations as well, so a very ecumenical community as well as we're preparing leaders for many places. Over half of our students are in the Master of Divinity program, which is the program that prepares pastors for the church, but we also have a PhD program and a Doctor of Ministry program for advanced studies for pastors and other leaders in the church, as well as a robust Master of Arts program for people who are feeling called to ministry, perhaps in children, youth, and family, or in music ministry in congregations, but also might be preparing for work in the nonprofit world or enhancing their own sense of vocation, wherever that's taking them, and wanting to explore that through a theological lens as well. So we're happy to welcome many kinds of students who are preparing for many different ministries in the church and the world. So we're you might be wondering, well, what are ways that you can interact with us at the seminary and ways that you can support the ministry that we are doing there? So let me think about a couple of ways with you. First of all, as your pastor already mentioned this morning, your financial gifts are a great benefit to us at the seminary. The tuition that our students pay only covers 27% of the costs of educating students, and so we rely on donors and other partners to join us in that work of raising up and preparing leaders. And as she already mentioned too, we strive to support our students with scholarship money as well to help pay for their tuition efforts. And so we join with many supporters from across the country who allow us to give most of our students some type of scholarship to help with their costs so that their debt is not so large when they are, and then they are able to go out into the communities that need pastors all across the country. So let me tell you a couple of stories of a few of our students. One is named Elise, and she's actually comes from the Northwest Minnesota Synod and is a senior now and preparing to be ready for her first call in this next year. And she talks a lot about the scholarship that she got that actually allowed her to go to seminary at this point in her life, that she would not have financially been able to find a way to go to seminary at this point. And she tells a very strong story about the fact that the scholarship allowed her to do this now as a young adult, and so she'll have many years to serve in the church, and we are grateful for that. There's a young man named Dean who was an intern in Brainerd just a few, well, we drove past Brainerd last night, so I assume it's kind of close around this area. And he, when he was on internship, he worked with the congregation that he was serving. He has an interest in baking and bread ministry, and they started baking bread together as a community that they then would donate to the food shelf. And it was an important place for him to live out his own vocation, not only in preparing for pastoral ministry, but to share his gifts of bread baking with the community as well. And we had a recent graduate named Irene who came to us from Ghana and was excited to come and learn the tools that she needed in our Master of Arts program. And she is now teaching at Good News Seminary in Ghana. And we give thanks for all the ways that we can support the body of Christ all around the world in raising up leaders. So thank you for your gifts. These gifts make a difference for people and allow them to think about their life as a public leader in the church. And secondly, you may be wondering about your own leadership gifts for ministry. We rely on churches around the world to point out to people, you are a person that has leadership gifts. And we think that you could really, we want to encourage you to think about seminary. And so if you're wondering about that yourself, or if you know someone that you think may have the gifts for ministry, we would be glad to talk with you today. And even if today is not the right time for you to think about that, your pastor is always available to have those conversations as well. We know that when seeds are planted and people are recognized for their gifts in ministry, they start to wonder about ways that they can be involved with that. And even if it's not pastoral ministry, there are a lot of ways that the church uses the gifts that you have to raise up leaders. And so we are grateful for that as well. And last, we are very grateful for your prayers. As you know, theological education is very different from when your pastor and I went to seminary. We have programs that our students are across the country and study with us distributedly, and we are bringing in people from all over the world, and the concept of how we do education is very different than it was 20 years ago. And the innovation is exciting and it's overwhelming all at the same time. And so we are grateful for your prayers, for the ministry that's happening at seminaries across our church. I was grateful to see this information in your bulletin that highlights all of our partner congregation, our partner seminaries across the church. We are grateful for your prayers and grateful for the ways that you continue to pray for the people who are being prepared in those places, that they may be ready to serve God's church across the world. And we look forward to talking with you after the service today. We've brought some materials along that we'll be leaving at a table outside your pastor's office, and look forward to further conversation. Thanks for having us here today.
All right.
Thank you so much for making the journey up here to be with us today. Share that. It was a member of my little congregation in Henning, Minnesota that first said to me, why don't you think about going to seminary? You know, that was just a random passing conversation a long time ago. She wasn't a Sunday school teacher. She was just a member of the church. And she said, you know, why don't you think about that? Turns out I thought about it. So you have a lot of influence in the people in your lives, the younger people, and for you yourself. People of any age go to seminary and learn how to serve God in different ways and use their gifts to serve the church. So, all right, so let's continue worship with the readings this morning.
First reading is from Habakkuk 1:1-4. The oracle that the prophet Habakkuk saw. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help, and you will not listen? Or cry to you violence, and you will not save? Why do you not make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law becomes slack, and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous, therefore judgment comes forth perverted. I will stand at my watchpost and station myself on the rampant. I will keep watch to see what he will say to me and what he will answer according to my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision. Make it plain on tablets so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. The psalm will be read responsibly by verse. Psalm 137, 1 through 9. Do not be provoked by evildoers. Do not be jealous of those who do wrong. Put your trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and find safe pasture. Commit your way to the Lord. Put your trust in the Lord and see what God will do. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently. Do not be provoked by the one who prospers, the one who succeeds in evil schemes.
Refrain from anger, leave rage alone. Do not be provoked, but leave alone is evil.
For evildoers shall be cut off, but those who hope in the Lord shall possess the land. Second reading is from 2 Timothy 1 through 14. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers night and day, recalling your tears. I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother, Lois, and your mother, Eunice, and now I am sure lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within your thought and lying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed, then, of the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner. But join me within his suffering for the gospel, relying on the power of the God who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace. This grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, but has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel, I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. And for this reason, I suffer as I do, but I am not ashamed. For I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I'm sure that he is able to guard until the day what I have entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of the sound teaching that you have heard from me in the faith and the love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good treasure entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us. Here ends the reading.
Holy Gospel for this Lord's Day is from St. Luke, the 17th chapter. We read this Gospel together. The apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. The Lord replied, if you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, come here at once and take your place at the table? Would you not rather say to him, prepare supper for me, put on your apron, and serve me while I eat and drink? Later you may eat and drink. Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? When you have done all that you were ordered to do, say, we are worthless slaves. We have only done what we ought to have done. This is the word of the Lord. Let's confess our faith. We use the words of the Apostles' Creed. It's on page 105. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. And I invite the youth to come forward for the children's message at this time. Come on down. Good morning. Hello. It's good to see you. Good morning. Hi. How are you today? Pretty good? It's good to see you. Are you awake? Nod your head if you're awake. Are you awake? Well, Macy, do you want to come sit over here? Kendra, come on over. Lots of room. So today in the Bible reading, Jesus was talking about a mustard seed. Have any of you ever seen a mustard seed? You have. I know you have. I used to have a little container of mustard seeds that I would bring with me just to show, but who knows where it is? It's probably still in Texas. It maybe got lost in the move, but I was looking for it. But they're very tiny. They're like if you look at your pinky nail, you could fit like five or six of them on there. They're that tiny. They're really little. And Jesus says that if we had faith that was even as big as a teeny tiny mustard seed, that we could tell a mulberry tree to pick itself up and go be planted in the ocean, and it would do it. Have you seen many mulberry trees flying through the air lately? You have? Okay. Well, what Jesus is trying to say is that our faith might be small, but that's okay. That's enough. Because God can still do great things through even just a tiny bit of faith. Now, I have a question for you. Have you done anything kind for someone in the last week or so? Can you think of anything? Did you do anything kind for someone? Grown-ups, think about this too. Was there something that you did? Did you, you know, send a card to someone? Did you visit someone in the hospital? Did you compliment someone on something they were wearing? Did you do something nice this week? Anybody? Anybody want to tell me about it? Yeah?
I helped my teacher setting up vocabulary cards.
You helped your teacher with something. That's great. What did you do? You walked your brother's dog. Excellent. Yes, how about you? Oh, good. If sending cards is such a nice thing. It means so much to get that card in the mail. And all of these are good things. Did you do something? Yeah, you sent 100 cards to someone? That's amazing. That's awesome. That would take me a long time to do. So And all of those things, except maybe sending 100 cards, that's a pretty big thing. But all the other things were pretty little things, right? But yet, God is able to do an awful lot with small things. So if we each do a small kind action today, God is able to make that thing a wonderful thing in someone's life in ways that we don't even understand. And so this week I want you to think of something that you can do to help someone else. And you can know that when you do that, that you're sharing faith with that person in a way too. So will you please bow your heads and let's pray together this morning. Dear Lord, we thank you for all of the many ways that you give us each day to do something kind for someone else. And help us know that when we share love with other people, that we are showing them glimpses of you too. Help us, God, to be your people. Bless these children today and every day. We thank you for them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for coming up. You can go back to your seat. The Lord be with you. The church that I served in Texas, it was about 7 miles out in the country. And out my kitchen window, I could see the parish hall, which was about 50 paces to the east. There was a rock fence that the first Norwegian settlers to that area had painstakingly put together, rock by rock, and it surrounded the entire perimeter of the church grounds and the cemetery. If any of you have ever been to Norway, you know that there's lots of those rock fences around, and I can't help but think that it was kind of comforting for those Norwegian settlers to build their rock fence around the perimeter of the church and kind of make it look like home. And over the years, parishioners and former pastors had planted all sorts of beautiful trees and shrubs on the church property. There were 2 pear trees to the north of our house. There were 2 beautiful mimosa trees in the front yard. The boys used to love to climb those trees. And there were grapevines and climbing roses and honeysuckle that would climb up our gate out front. And directly out our back door, there were 2 mulberry trees. And once I found out what they were, I used to chuckle to myself, like I would picture the pastor who planted them years ago, like, you know, if he would ever think, you know, I wonder if someday the pastors who follow me are going to look out their kitchen window and see the mulberry trees out there and you know, take a cue from this verse from Luke and see if you can say to the mulberry trees, uproot yourselves and be planted in the ocean and see if they did it. I admit I tried a few times. The mulberry trees are still there, by the way. Well, in today's gospel, the disciples ask for more faith. We, like the disciples, we like that idea, don't we, of more faith. We think, oh, if only I just had more faith, maybe I'd be better off. Maybe I would feel better. What is faith? In Marcus Borg's book, it's a book called The Heart of Christianity, he talks about 4 different meanings of the word faith. We all know that faith takes many different shapes and forms, but he refers to these different forms by their Latin names. And he says that there's 4 main faces or shapes of faith. And the first is referred to by the Latin word assensus. It means belief or assent. And this is the predominant meaning in our culture. There are 2 main reasons for that it's prominent in modern Western Christianity, and the first is the Protestant Reformation. The Reformation produced all sorts of new denominations, and so correct doctrine, correct belief became very important because it distinguished you from what other people believed. And the second development happened in the Enlightenment, when truth became identified with what was factual. For many, Christian faith began to mean believing questionable things to be true. Faith was kind of what you turned to when everything else ran out. And so while thinking about faith as being something that you can believe with your head, it can be valid in many ways, but the difficulty is when we think of faith as only that way, well then what does it mean if you have doubts? There was a Carmelite nun who was being interviewed, and she was the mother superior of a cloistered convent. And the interviewer asked her, "What is the hardest thing about your job?" The interviewer said he thought she was going to say something like, "Oh, well, the food is bad and the hours are long." But what she said was, "The hardest part of her job is the doubt." She says she has great doubt. She struggles with it every day. The mother superior of a Carmelite convent, great doubt every day. Marcus Borg says, when you think about it, faith as being simply something that you can believe with your head is relatively powerless. You can believe all the right things and still be in bondage. You can believe all the right things and still be miserable. Understanding faith to be simply believing a set of claims to be true has very little transforming power. Now, the second form of faith is expressed in the Latin word fiducia. Fiducia is this radical trust in God. Not trusting a set of statements about God, but trusting God. Soren Kierkegaard describes it like this. He says, faith as trust is like floating in a deep ocean. If you struggle, if you tense up and you thrash about, what's going to happen to you? You're going to sink, right? But if you relax and if you trust, you float. This is the kind of faith that we display when we take a leap of faith, to go where God calls, even though it doesn't seem to make sense. To live the way that Jesus teaches, even when it feels contrary to everything the world will tell us. It's doing the scary thing, the uncomfortable thing. I like to think of, you all know Pastor Dean from First in Audubon, right? Did you know before he was a pastor, he was a chemist, very, very well-paid chemist. And he and his wife, they had two very small children when he left that behind to go to seminary and to follow his calling. Didn't make sense, you know, but he felt this deep in his heart, and they thought and prayed about it for years. And this is what is described when we think of that fiducia kind of faith, just trusting. The third face of faith, it's known by a term called fidelitas. Fidelitas is fidelity, loyalty, allegiance. It's a commitment of the deepest self. Fidelitas is like this. Do you feel like getting up every Sunday morning and coming to church? Maybe not, but you come anyway. It's that commitment. It's knowing that it matters that you're here, that your spirit is fed. It's committing to participating in the sacraments. We do that, not because we understand them completely, not because we feel particularly motivated maybe all the time, but because Jesus asked us to do that, so we do it. It's fidelity. It's hanging in there for the long haul. It's not being swerved by the winds of emotion. And if the sun looks really great on the lake this morning and I think, wow, I'd really like to be out there. But no, we come here. We come together. Fidelity. Steady. And then fourth, there's faith as visio. Faith as a way of seeing. That we share God's worldview for compassion for neighbors. Our faith is expressed in sharing Jesus' all-encompassing love. And so faith that has all these different shapes and forms, belief, trust, commitment, vision. And in the gospel for today, Jesus talks about how it's not the size of your faith that matters, because God can do anything with the faith that we have. Really quickly, in verses 7 through 10, there's that part where it talks about the servant. The slave comes in from the field and serves the master before the slave himself eats. And what's that all about? Well, servants weren't invited to eat with the landowner. They eat when their work is done. They don't expect thanks for doing their job. They just do it. And that's what faith is like. Jesus seems to say that willingness to do what needs to be done and realizing there is a faithfulness in that. The people that Jesus called faithful, they weren't illustrious or famous. I mean, think about it. The people that Jesus called faithful, the centurion concerned for a sick servant, a woman just grateful that she was forgiven. He said, "You're faithful." That leper, remember the story, the leper, the one leper who turned around to come and say thank you for healing me. Jesus called him faithful. The blind beggar who asked Jesus for sight, he was faithful. Faith is not found in these mighty acts of heaven, but in the ordinary and everyday doing what needs to be done. And do you know that I see faith being played out in each one of you all the time? In small and great ways, every day you display it. When you show up here for worship, when you bring that can of food for the food shelf, when you arrive at your job every morning and you do your job as fully as you can and with honesty and integrity, when you take care of the family that God has entrusted to you, when you honor your parents by listening to them, paying them respect, when you pray for your neighbor who's going through that time, when you send the card that says, "Hey, I'm thinking about you," when you show up to vote, even if you think the field of candidates is very discouraging, we tend to dismiss all of these small acts as being nothing that great in displaying faith. What is it? It's just stuff we do, right? Because it needs to happen. But imagine if none of these small acts of faithfulness that each of us did in the last week, what if none of them happened? Life and faith, it's made up of the small things, the ordinary things, because God can do great things through the smallest things, even as small as a mustard seed. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you. We thank you for every opportunity we get to be of help, to be of service. Help us to spot those ways that we might lend a comforting word, that we might share a bit of mercy, a bit of grace, forgiveness, hope, somehow with someone today. Lord, we lift up all who are in need of our prayers today. We pray for those who are facing surgery this week. We pray for your comfort and peace to surround them. Help them to know that you are right there with them. All is well. We pray for those who are lonesome, those who would long for a friendly voice to call them, someone to check how they're doing. Bring those people to mind for us, God, and help us make the phone call. Stop by. We pray for our children, God. Raise them up in this faith. Help us to do that. Help us to teach them about you. And inspire all of our hearts to serve you in whatever way we can. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's join in singing our hymn, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less.
Another spotlight to share about organizations are Benevolence Fund benefits. First, Special Olympics helps provide sports, training, and competition for special needs children. It inspires health, joy, and confidence. Second, the Dorothy Day House helps men who are homeless. They see these individuals find homes from broken down and tired to housed and full of hope. Third, the Lakes Crisis and Resource Center here in Detroit Lakes provides a nurturing, caring, and safe environment for those who are hurt by crime and violence. A note on their advertising was of a mother and two boys that were mentally and physically abused by the husband and father. This program gave them a gift of a bright future. Thank you for all you do.
Please stand as the offering is brought forward. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this to remember me." We pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. We stand for the blessing. The body and blood of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace until life everlasting. Amen. And as we sing our closing song today, we're going to sing just the first verse of Beautiful Savior. because God can do great things through the smallest things, even as small as a mustard seed. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you. We thank you for every opportunity we get to be of help, to be of service. Help us to spot those ways that we might lend a comforting word, that we might share a bit of mercy, a bit of grace, forgiveness, hope, somehow with someone today. Lord, we lift up all who are in need of our prayers today. We pray for those who are facing surgery this week. We pray for your comfort and peace to surround them. Help them to know that you are right there with them. All is well. We pray for those who are lonesome, those who would long for a friendly voice to call them, someone to check how they're doing. Bring those people to mind for us, God, and help us make the phone call. Stop by. We pray for our children, God. Raise them up in this faith. Help us to do that. Help us to teach them about you. And inspire all of our hearts to serve you in whatever way we can. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's join in singing our hymn, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less.
Thank you.
Another spotlight to share about organizations, our Benevolence Fund benefits. First, Special Olympics helps provide sports, training, and competition for special needs children. It inspires health, joy, and confidence. Second, the Dorothy Day House helps men who are homeless. They see these individuals find homes from broken down and tired to housed and full of hope. Third, the Lakes Crisis and Resource Center here in Detroit Lakes provides a nurturing, caring, and safe environment for those who are hurt by crime and violence. A note on their advertising was of a mother and two boys that were mentally and physically abused by the husband and father. This program gave them a gift of a bright future. Thank you for all you do.
Please stand as the offering is brought forward. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this to remember me." We pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
We stand for the blessing. The body and blood of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace until life everlasting. Amen. And as we sing our closing song today, we're going to sing just the first verse of Beautiful Savior.